So we're here with Bob Sheil, who's the director of the Bartlett School of Architecture. Thanks for joining us, Bob.
Pleasure.
The interest that you've really been exploring, both through your own practice, but also through your own models of education, which has been the new forms of practice that are emerging when we see the tools of drawing and the tools of making collapsing together. Can you tease out a little bit about what some of these technologies, how they first started to make their way into your purview and how you started to work with them as an educator?
My interest and, say, history and journey through architecture is always dictated by people and the time we live in. But at the end of the 20th century, it just exploded in terms of the tools we use to even explore and consider architecture. The work that you're getting into, mm-hmm. I can take that back to the 90s, you know, in the introduction of narrative, the introduction of immersive experience, and how we're always trying to chase that sense of an architectural completeness as idea makers, in a sense. Things that you know, tickle me are often things that contradict what you're meant to be doing, you know.
It's bizarre that educational institutions are still, for the most part, training students for a form of practice that really, in many ways, no longer exists. And it seems like that's something that the Bartlett, also something that SCI-Arc is trying to do, is what Hernan describes as a model of architectural thinking as opposed to a model of architecture full stop. How is that starting to play out in a school like the Bartlett? How are you starting to introduce these alternative models of what practice could be?
I think the most important engine in any school are the students and seeing what's motivating them coming into architecture. Our first years were born in the year 2000, and their expectation for the future is discussed in many ways much more graphically than mine was. And they'll hit this sort of cold face of their career in 2035. Mm-hmm. So I think architecture has always been, for me, a way of trying to make sense of where we're going in relation to the future. And it's the near future, the far future, whatever it might be. I find, as I'm getting older, is I'm noticing much more from students. I read students much more now than I say I did 20 years ago. Mm. The reality that they may not end up in, you know, the mainstream, you know, stereotype of practice. And that's a good thing, to kind of query that and offer choices along the way. But its diversity and its rigor and its energy now is phenomenal.
Architects have been great wanderers, drifting in and out of other people's fields, but it's always been through some kind of force of will or just a sheer hustle. I think what's interesting is that the new programs you're starting to create, just like the programs that we're trying to set up here at SCI-Arc, are trying to facilitate and scaffold those kind of transitions out of traditional practice into these allied territories.
Yeah, I totally agree with all of that. I think there are two aspects to that. One is the sort of the delta that emerges from the graduation, but there's also the other end of the scale of like who you're reaching out to appeal to come into the school in the first place. And it's extraordinary, you know, how that maturity, but also diversity, is noticed in the school very, very quickly.
Yeah, so the students, yeah, so are, the students are bringing in different kind of journeys, kind of,
journeys and experiences.
They're asking different questions. So, you know,
one of the worst things that can often happen at school is to become so successful, it's fearful of losing that success. But, you know, the only thing that matters is your determination to reinvent yourself and open things up all the time. And, you know, on that point, one of the most important energies in a school is the sense of the unknown, the uncertain, you know. If you get comfortable, it's over. At the core of an architecture school, what makes it really tick is to embrace uncertainty.
Out of some of the programs you're doing, you're not trying to make performance artists in the same way that a drama school might, you know.
Sure.
What do you think it is that the architecture school adds, or how do you think that changes it, the fact that they're there and not somewhere else?
I mean, at their essence, all really strong architecture schools are provocateurs. And there's also a core of naivety in a lot of architecture schools, which is incredibly valuable. And yet, just jump into them and say, I can do this, I can think this through. And, you know, sometimes it's a disaster what happens. It doesn't work out at all. But occasionally, it works out unbelievably well. But it is something that we're kind of seem to be wired up to do. It's our kind of DNA.
I think there's a boldness there that we intuitively have just to get out there and do it. We exist between culture and technology in a way that's actually quite rare now.
Yeah.
So we can get drunk in a bar and have an interesting conversation with an artist. And I think that capacity to be in a room and have different kinds of conversations is something which is one of our strengths.
One thing that I think we haven't reflected on enough in past decades is others can be us. Like I said earlier, with these other programs inviting applicants and researchers in from different disciplines, from the sciences, from humanities, from the arts, from the trades, there's a really strong sense of them being entirely integrated into what a school is. We're surrounding that group with all sorts of other forms of practice and discipline that are complementary, they're not threatening. And I think that's very different to what it was when I was a student, you know, way back in the 80s. A school was very heavily defined by the mythology of the practicing architect, the sole male, generally, figure of the practicing architect. Whereas now, a school's defined by the subject of architecture and how blurred the edges of that subject are. And I think that's great.
If we're not making buildings as singular objects in the world, what are we doing? That doesn't mean that we're no longer architects, but it might mean we're architects operating inside the BBC, architects operating inside Hollywood, almost like Trojan horses.
But it just illustrates how an organization which is itself is the scale of a university is looking to architecture graduates for different things now. They're looking to architecture graduates to ask questions of them, as opposed to help them deliver what they're doing.
People like Cool House reverting to the fundamentals, or the move back towards the neo-postmodern, and the idea that this kind of diversification is somehow a weakening or a dissolution of the term architect, but potentially it's also a strengthening of it, because at the same time we're finding new ways to actually affect change.
These new forms of practice, these new forms of education are driven by rigorous kind of, you know, structures of study. So just as rigorous as any other, just as rigorous as medicine, law, or accredited architecture. I'm confident at the moment with that diversity and pluralism in schools will make the subject and the discipline and the profession, you know, a far more productive and meaningful player in the world. So I'm optimistic.
You've also been making work, your own work. Like, I wonder for you how a lot of these themes start to play out in your own practice, or perhaps maybe how some of these tools and the application of these tools shape what it is you do when you're not director of the school.
In reality, what I've been focused on the last 4 or 5 years isn't actually so much about the tools, although people may laugh, you know, when they see how many we've got. It's actually people, you know, it's finding the right people to hire to come in and open up that potential to students who are hungry to learn. And they're pretty rare to find, and you spend most of your time searching for them. But when you get them, you know, the rewards are huge. And I think that's been, for me, where I've now applied my previous kind of, you know, 15, 20 years of teaching and practice.
I mean, you did try and, I guess, condense some of that thinking about scanning and those processes into the book High Definition, and it fundamentally changes the whole tradition of what architecture and design has been.
Yeah. I mean, ultimately, that kind of technology is at its most powerful when it's verifying things, it's verifying the difference between the drawn and the made. But of course, you know, people like myself, I'm sure you're the same, we want tolerance in our work, you know, and that was the thinking behind the title of that book, was Negotiating Zero Tolerance. You know, when I was trained, you designed to plus or minus 10 millimeters, yeah? And now it's, you know, submicron. And that's not necessarily helpful. It's not necessarily a good thing. The construction industry is not set up for that. So we need to bring back in a conversation about what's the value of tolerance, you know, in a positive way, rather than it seemed to be an error.
We need to bring back in a conversation around all of these tools in a way, because just because they're new and they're shiny doesn't necessarily mean they're productive. And I guess that brings us back to where we started, is that that's a critical role of us as architects, is to play out these futures and see which ones stick.
Right? Yeah, I couldn't agree more. So I think that's very true. I think that's exactly the sort of spirit I hope, you know, we impart in all our work. Yeah.
All right. Thanks, Bob, for
Thank you, Liam.
Coming in.
It was fun.
Thanks for chatting.
Cheers.